It's great to see you all here. I'm Judith Mowry. I'm the Senior Policy Advisor from the office in Portland, Oregon. And I have the pleasure of introducing our keynote speaker. Continue to get your lunches, make yourselves comfortable. You're in for a treat. We're really excited that our keynote today is Ian Hanley López. Ian is the John H. Bolt Professor of Law at the University of California, Berkeley, where he teaches in the areas of race and constitutional law. One of the nation's leading thinkers on racism's evolution in the United States since the Civil Rights era, Ian's current research emphasizes the connection between racial divisions and growing wealth inequality in the United States. His most recent book, Dog Whistle Politics, How Coded Racial Appeals Have Reinvented Racism and Wrecked the Middle Class, lays bare how over the last 50 years, politicians have exploited racial pandering to convince many voters to support policies that ultimately favor the very wealthiest while hurting everyone else. And you all have the books in your bags. So without any further ado, please welcome Ian Hanley López.
Well, I'd like to start with thank yous. Thank you to Paula for inviting me here, and thank you to Judith for that kind introduction. Perhaps more importantly, thank you to all of you for the incredible work you're doing advancing racial equity. It really is an inspiration. I really do hope you sort of applaud yourselves. So some people are listening, it's okay. Do applaud yourselves, because you're doing amazing work. But here's what I want to do with this talk. I want to say, and this will get your attention, how you're part of the problem. Part of the problem, at least from the point of view of the right. Because conservatives, and I actually don't even mean conservatives. I actually mean big money interests, which now passes as conservatism. But big money interests are using you as a way to demonize government, as a way to create hostility towards government that facilitates the hijacking of government by the very richest, by the corporations, and at the same time supports slashing those government programs that would actually help the rest of us. Let me try and say this one more time, just really, really, really concisely. Race is being used to demonize good government. And the quintessential way that's done is to say that government is really about helping minorities. It's not for decent, hardworking Americans, code white. So that you all are symptomatic of what's wrong with government. That you're really just about helping minorities, you're not for the decent, hardworking folks who built this country, right? You are being used as a weapon to demonize government. And I want to try and put all of this in this context in a 50-year history that ends up coming back and saying, well, what do we do? And what I want to urge is two basic solutions. One, a social movement that emphasizes inclusion, and that in order to achieve inclusion will require that we directly address race. And two, an effort to rehabilitate the image of government, to advance and articulate the idea of good government, government for all. And I want to think in those terms, in terms of an inclusion revolution and in terms of good government, about how you might reimagine your roles as you promote racial equity. Okay, let's get started. Dog whistle politics. Let's be clear about the term. Dog whistle politics. Thug, illegal alien, the poor, the middle class, all of these are dog whistle terms. They're dog whistle terms in the sense that, like a dog whistle, they're operating in two registers. A dog whistle blows at so high a frequency human ears can't hear it. It's silent, but on another frequency, it's producing sharp reactions in dogs. Our political speech is operating in the same way. On one register, it's silent about race. Thug, illegal alien, Sharia, Muslim terrorists. On the surface, no reference to race. But just underneath, these terms are producing sharp racial reaction. These coded terms have been used by politicians essentially for the last 50 years to warn whites that government is really about coddling minorities and refusing to control them, and that whites should then turn against government in a way that has dramatic implications, not only for communities of color, who are those who are being demonized, and you can think here about mass incarceration or mass deportation, the defunding of our public schools, the slashing of our welfare systems, tremendous negative consequences for communities of color, but also big shifts in how our government and how our market work in a way that has hurt everybody, white and non-white alike. And so to illustrate that, I usually show this graph. I've emancipated this from Robert Reich. He doesn't mind. Right, this is from Inequality for All. And so here's the story that Reich tells, because this is one of the early graphs that he shows. He says, look at what's happened in terms of the wealthiest 1% and their share of national income. In 1928, roaring 20s, right before the Great Depression, they controlled about 28% of the national income. And then the Great Depression, wealth is wiped out, but New Deal, we enact a series of policies that help build the middle class, and wealth inequality goes down, plateaus around 1970, and then around 1980, it starts to increase. And where are we now? Well, you see this sort of downward tick. That was the recession of 2007-2008 that wiped out a lot of wealth at the top, but you know that more than 95% of the recovery since 2008 has gone to the top 1%, and we're right back up at levels of wealth inequality we haven't seen in a century, right? That is, something's going on in our country that is leading to increasing concentrations of wealth among the very rich. What? Well, if you ask that question as a question about policy, then Robert Reich, Paul Krugman, Joe Stiglitz, they can tell you the answer. The answers are very simple. We have a series of policies that slash taxes for the very wealthiest, increase taxes on the poor, that lead to corporate takeover of the government, which means that they're writing their own regulations in terms of environment, in terms of monopoly, in terms of competition, and also in terms of workplace conditions, to the deleterious impact on unions. And also, we're slashing government programs like public education, like investment in infrastructure, like housing programs that would actually help build the middle class. We know the policies that are doing this. What we don't know is the politics. Why is this politics, the politics that is producing surging inequality, popular in a democracy? Right? This is not just the top 1% or 0.1% voting for this. Why? And that's the story I want to tell. That's the story I think that really centers on race. To tell it, I want to focus on this individual, start with this individual. This is 1964, Barry Goldwater. So Barry Goldwater is a senator from Arizona. He's a scion of a wealthy retail family. He's a diehard conservative. He fancies himself a cowboy. And now this cowboy business from Arizona, it's not just sort of sartorial affectation, it's political ideology. He's a cowboy in the sense that he believes that we should all stand on our own two feet, that we should, out of the goodness of our hearts, help our family, help our community, but that ultimately we owe nobody anything, nor does anybody owe us anything. So that if we succeed, like one succeeds when they're a child of a wealthy family, then you keep everything. But if you fail, then be a good cowboy and have the dignity to lean up against that cactus and die silently. Right? And this is his political ideology, and so he wants to dismantle the New Deal. And he knows he's never going to get elected, because the New Deal at this point is really popular. This is 1964. The country has experienced the biggest expansion of the middle class the country and the world has ever seen. People love the New Deal. He knows he's not going to get elected campaigning against the New Deal directly or exclusively, so he has a strategy. This is the only text I'm going to show you. It's important. This is the strategy. In 1963, the Republican National Committee meets in Denver, And Robert Novak, a conservative journalist, writes an article summarizing what it is that they've decided. They've decided to exploit the racial crisis. Some of you know that as the civil rights movement. They're going to exploit the racial crisis by becoming the white man's party. Now, I want to be clear. This is really important. This is not racism. This is not racism, at least not in the sense that you might be thinking. Because if there's a white man's party in 1963, it's the Southern Democrats. They're the party of the white supremacists. They're the party that has been using fraud and law and violence to disenfranchise African Americans all across the South. It's the Southern Democrats that is essentially a party by and for whites only, not the Republicans. So this isn't a sort of white supremacist, hate every black person kind of a decision. This is strategy. This is the Republicans saying to themselves, hey, the civil rights movement, it is increasing anxiety among whites. Whites are getting nervous. We can take advantage of that. There's an opening here. We can use that to drive a wedge into the New Deal coalition of Northeastern elites, African Americans, the white working class. Let's do it. So it's strategy. Second point. In fact, though not in name, exactly because of the civil rights movement, you can't go out and succeed politically anymore by 63 by saying, I stand here today as the proud representative of the white race. That language had been working, but now it doesn't work anymore. It needs to be in code. And this is where we switch to a dog whistle politics, coded appeals to white anxiety. So what would Goldwater say? Goldwater started the campaign on two themes, states' rights and freedom of association. Now, maybe you all understand the racial resonance of those terms. I mean, when you first hear them, most people, they don't get it. And you think, states' rights, how boring a campaign theme could that be? We're going to have a national campaign on the relative power of states versus the federal government? Right? I mean, I teach constitutional law where that's one of the major themes. I can't get my students through 3 minutes of that, let alone a national campaign, until you realize in 1963, 1964, states' rights meant the right of southern states to refuse to integrate. States' rights was the power of the South to refuse to bow down to the order of Brown versus Board of Education that their schools integrate. It was their excuse for saying, we want to continue our white supremacist ways. That's what states' rights meant. And freedom of association, again, this is some sort of philosophical abstraction. Free to be, I get to associate with whoever I want, pick my own friends. What? Until you understand it meant the right of white businesses and white homeowners to refuse to rent or to allow the entrance of African Americans into their places of business. Right. That's what freedom of association meant. And these are the themes that Goldwater campaigned on. How'd he do? Terrible. Absolutely terrible. He was crushed. He was crushed. It was a massive landslide. And why? Because people understood that Goldwater was campaigning against the New Deal. He was campaigning in 1964 against Lyndon Johnson, who was promising to expand the New Deal into the Great Society. And now I want to switch. I want to show you. This is a Lyndon Johnson ad from 1964. I want you to watch this ad and think about how revolutionary it would be if a presidential candidate today were running this ad.
Poverty is not a trait of character. It is created anew in each generation, but not by heredity, by circumstances. Today, millions of American families are caught in circumstances beyond their control. Their children will be compelled to live lives of poverty unless the cycle is broken. President Johnson's war on poverty has this one goal: to provide everyone a chance to grow and make his own way. A chance at education. A chance at training. A chance at a fruitful life. For the first time in the history of America, this can be done. Vote for President Johnson on November 3rd. The stakes are too high for you to stay home.
Think about that ad. Think about if we had a candidate from either party who stood up and said, I want to be your president, and I vow I will end poverty. We have a moral obligation to do so. We know how to do so. We have the resources to do so. We should do so. Let's end poverty. Think about how revolutionary that would be. Think also about the face of poverty. When's the last time you saw poverty presented with a white face? Because that's part of what's happening here. Coming out of the New Deal programs, these were shaped consciously in response to pressure from the white supremacist Southern Democrats in a way that would largely help whites only. And the result of that is that in 1964, when people are voting to support the New Deal, and two out of three whites did, they understand the New Deal, they understand anti-poverty initiatives as programs for whites. And understanding these programs as programs that helped people like themselves, white Americans voted two-thirds to support Lyndon Johnson. Many people reacted to this by saying, well, that's it then. It's a consensus. This has been a landslide. The anti-New Deal candidate has been crushed. It's over. We are fundamentally a liberal country that believes in an activist government that will pour its resources into ending poverty. That's what most pundits said in 1964. But, like a distant alarm in the night, those red states. One of them was Arizona. I won't say more about that. The other five are five states in the Deep South with the largest African American population, and this is a shock. This is a shock. These are states in the Deep South, essentially white voters only, and they hate Republicans. No, sorry. That's too mild a word. They loathe them, they detest them, their guts tie in knots to think about Republicans. Why? Well, you know, there was Lincoln. But even more, Brown versus Board of Education was a decision written by a former Republican governor, Earl Warren. And when the first troops are ordered into the South, the first federal troops are ordered into the South to enforce integration, is by Dwight Eisenhower, a Republican president. The South, they for generations they have sworn they will never vote for a Republican. And also, they love the New Deal. The South, much more than the North, was destroyed by the economic calamity of the Great Depression and depended much more upon the saving federal investment of the government. In fact, if you think about something like the Tennessee Valley Authority, that New Deal program brought electricity for the first time to millions across the South. They love the New Deal. And Goldwater, he's running around the South saying he is going to privatize, to sell off the TVA. Right? And so, but wait. The people who hate the Republicans the most, who love the New Deal the most, are now voting for a Republican who promises to sell off the New Deal? And that's the threat, that the most committed Democrats, the most committed proponents of the New Deal system can be convinced to vote Democrat, convinced to vote Republican, convinced to vote against an activist government, if appealed to in racial terms. That's the warning coming out of the South. Tricky Dick Nixon. Would this racial appeal work? Well, it sure didn't in 64. So Nixon was leery coming into 1968. And he continued his path as a racial moderate and also as a moderate Republican. Right up until about 1970, so he barely squeaked by. He was elected in 68, barely squeaked by. In 1970, a couple of number crunchers on both sides of the political aisle spoke. Kevin Phillips on the Republican side wrote a book that crunched the numbers and said, it is clear coded racial appeals can be used to break the New Deal coalition and to assemble a new and enduring Republican majority. And on the Democratic side, a couple of Democratic strategists said the same thing. And so the consensus seemed to solidify in 1970. Use race to divide the electorate, to stir the anxiety of white voters, to create a new Republican majority. And this is what Nixon started to do in his, as he geared up for his 1972 campaign. He started to talk about forced busing. That was the northern analog of states' rights, because forced busing, as if the issue were busing. No. The emotional wallop behind forced busing was Nixon's promise that he would not force northern schools to integrate through the use of buses. He started to talk about law and order and crime control. And there the code was, African Americans are criminals. We need to protect you from these threatening forces. In fact, Nixon, so this is one of the benefits of Nixon having illegal taping devices all over the White House. We know Nixon, watching one of his own commercials that was talking about law and order, said, that's it. This campaign commercial hits it right on the head. It's all about law and order and those damn Negro Puerto Rican groups. Right? Nixon knew that he was race baiting, but he was race baiting in code, law and order, forced busing, states' rights. This is the language that Nixon used, silent majority. How'd he do? Lyndon Johnson won 67% of the white vote in 1964. Richard Nixon, 8 years later, won 70% of the white vote. 70%. And now the pundits turned around and said, well, this marks a sort of a new direction. We are actually, it turns out, a conservative country. All of that New Deal business and that Great Society business, that was just an aberration. We're coming back to our conservative core. I don't buy it. I don't think we're fundamentally a conservative country. In fact, when you look at polls and you ask at a sort of high enough level of generality, do you think government ought to provide for decent jobs, for health care, for adequate education, infrastructure? People say yes, in huge numbers, 60, 70, 80%. This is not about conservatism in that sense. This is about racial conservatism. This is about the southernization of US politics, the way that race shaped the way whites in the South reacted to Goldwater. That's how it shaped how they reacted to Richard Nixon in 1972. But this is only the first half of Dog Whistle Politics. This is the first half that says, hey, race can be used to scare white voters. That's not the most important half. The most important half is what's going to happen to government. And for that half, we go on to Richard Nixon. All right, so this is Richard Nixon. Ronald Reagan. Another face of Richard Nixon. No. Much worse, actually, much worse. So Nixon was a moderate, right? A power-hungry megalomaniac, but a moderate, if that's what it took, okay. Ronald Reagan is a dyed-in-the-wool conservative. He gets his start in politics in 1964 as a campaign spokesperson for Barry Goldwater. He's one of these sort of hate the New Deal, hate liberal government, dismantle new government as you can. He's also highly skilled in the politics of racial provocation. This is a picture of Ronald Reagan. He has just won the official nomination to be the Republican candidate for president. This is his first official campaign stop. It's in Neshoba County, Mississippi. Infamous because 16 years earlier, three civil rights workers had been kidnapped there, lynched, their bodies stuffed in an earthen dam and not found for months. For his first official campaign appearance as the Republican candidate for president, Ronald Reagan goes to Neshoba County, Mississippi, and he says, I stand for states' rights. And this is Goldwater. This is the language that says to whites, I'm on your side. I'm going to stand with you to resist the pressures of integration, the demands being made by minorities. But he does more than engage in that sort of racial provocation. He starts to tell a new story. And so let me tell you a version of that story because it'll really give you a sense of what has happened to our country. Reagan starts to look out at audiences, at his audiences, and they are overwhelmingly white audiences. And he repeatedly shares this story. He says, I know how frustrated you are, how angry you are, when you're standing in line at a grocery store to buy hamburger, and some young fellow is standing ahead of you to buy a T-bone steak with food stamps. Now, the first time he told that story, he was worried it would be too subtle. So he didn't say some young fellow. He said some young buck. A southern term meaning a strong black man, one resistant to white authority, maybe one who lusts after white women. That was too loud. That wasn't a dog whistle anymore. That was a bullhorn. He was roundly criticized, so he dropped the some young buck, but he didn't drop the story. And the story stood, and the story worked because of the racial characters. The first racial character is the character of this young fellow with food stamps to buy T-bone steak. And that's an image of African Americans, not just as lazy. They're strong. They could work. They just don't want to. They would prefer to rip off the system. It's not that they're lazy, it's that they're schemers, it's that they're thieves, it's that they're trying to get over on everybody else. And they're living high off the hog. They're eating T-bone steak when they do so. That's African Americans. And what about whites? Well, that's the you that Reagan was talking to. And he's saying, I know you. You work hard. You play by the rules. You built this country. And what do you got? Hamburger. I know you're angry. I know you're frustrated. And he's saying to whites, you're the hard workers, the ones who play by the rules, and you're the ones getting ripped off. But the most important character here is not the fellow with the food stamps, it's not the white person, it's government. Because Reagan's saying to whites, blame government. It's government that's reaching its hands into your pockets, that's taking your hard-earned money in taxes, and that's wasting it in giveaways on these scheming minorities. It's government which is refusing to protect you from minorities, coddling them in terms of criminal law, indeed pushing them into your neighborhoods, into your workplace, into your children's school. Resent government. And do something about it. What? We'll cut taxes. We'll slash regulations because we can't trust government, we ought to trust the marketplace. And cut all of these government programs like education, like welfare, because that's just wasted money on minorities. But at the same time, ramp up spending on crime control, because that's how we're gonna keep those minorities down. That's how we're gonna keep you safe. Those are his basic prescriptions. Chief among them, cut taxes. And so under Reagan, people supported these massive tax cuts, some of the biggest tax cuts in the history of this country. Did they go to those hardworking, long-suffering whites? During the 1980s, the Reagan tax cuts transferred a trillion dollars of wealth to the top 1%. And those tax cuts have never been repealed, and each decade since, the Reagan tax cuts have transferred a further trillion plus to the top 1%. And when you look at that Robert Reich graph, and you see 1980, and then you see wealth inequality start to climb from 1980 onwards, think trillion dollars a decade to the top 1%, decade after decade after decade. Cut taxes for the very rich. Give corporations control over their regulations. Cut the social services that help build the middle class, and do all of those because you hate government because it just coddles minorities and refuses to control them. That's the heart of dog whistle politics. That's the heart. Okay, some caveats. It's not all race. It's not just race. Once Republicans saw how effective race could be used as a wedge issue, they began to look for other wedge issues. And they very quickly hit upon abortion, on gender and family dynamics more generally, on religion, on sexual orientation, on guns, right? So all of this has been part of this larger culture war politics in which conservatives have said to voters, fear these people who are trying to drag you down, who don't respect you, who are trying to take away from your status, trying to insult your religion. Don't worry about increasing concentrations of wealth and power in the corporations. That's been the basic statement. Beyond the culture war politics, the basic conservative message is resent government. And listen, coming out of the 70s, coming out of the 80s, there was a lot to resent. Vietnam War, Watergate, and then since then, Republicans, whenever they gain power, do whatever they can to make government dysfunctional. Right? It's not like, oh my God, they can't govern. They refuse to govern. They don't want to govern, at least in a way that helps most people, because what they want to do is increase frustration with government, because that's their basic message, hate government. Meanwhile, of course, they're busy handing over government to the very rich. So Reagan kept talking about cutting the size of government, slashing the federal deficit. Did it go down under Reagan? Did the size of government go down under Reagan? No, it went up. But more and more of government was passed to the very rich instead of to the rest of us, right? So that's their basic politics. One last caveat, whites. I keep talking about whites, 60% of whites, 70% of whites. When I say whites, I don't actually mean whites in the sense of fair-skinned people of European descent. I mean people who subscribe to a notion of whiteness. It's whiteness that's the problem, not biology, not skin color, eye color, hair color, whiteness. And what is whiteness? Whiteness is a sense that some of us belong, some of us are deserving, some of us are hardworking, and others don't belong. We're foreigners, we're dangerous, we're criminals, we're lazy. And that this difference between the some of us who are decent and who deserve respect and dignity and others who are dangerous and who should be excluded, who should be marginalized, that that difference somehow connects up to race. Now, I want to be clear. Whiteness as a set of ideals, for some people, it's completely conscious. And they're usually Klan members, and sometimes they have a swastika tattooed to their forehead. That's conscious. But for a lot of people, it's just the stories we're telling about society that seem to resonate with them, and that's where Dog Whistle Politics comes in. A lot of people who are responding to Dog Whistle Politics, they are not out-and-out racist. They're not out-and-out bigots, though I guarantee some are. Rather, they're people who say, hey, I would never vote for a politician who stands up and says, I'm for white people. But when a politician stands up and says, we got to slam the door shut on the southern border because people are bringing in disease and it's a culture of lawlessness and Ebola's coming across the southern border and there are thugs in Baltimore and we need to protect against Sharia in the heartland, a lot of people say, yeah, that's whiteness talking. That's whiteness that says to them, there are decent, hardworking people who look like you, and there are dangerous, diseased, criminal people who don't, and they're a threat to your society. Do what you can to stand against that threat. That's whiteness, right? And so I want to be clear, right? That's what's so dangerous here. Not white per se, not European descent. And look at the numbers. We're still talking 25% of white strong supporters of the Tea Party. That's not everybody. But those people who are deeply invested in the Tea Party and the racial narratives of the Tea Party, a lot of that is a subscription to notions of whiteness, that some of us belong and others of us don't, and that that codes to race, culture, and behavior. Okay, let's go on. Willie Horton. William Horton, except that it made more sense to call him Willie, so they started calling him Willie. This is George Bush the first campaign commercial. He's in bad trouble. You'll recognize this. See if you, well, maybe. I think you will.
Bush and Dukakis on crime. Bush supports the death penalty for first-degree murderers. Dukakis not only opposes the death penalty, he allowed first-degree murderers to have weekend passes from prison. One was Willie Horton, who murdered a boy in a robbery, stabbing him 19 times. Despite a life sentence, Horton received 10 weekend passes from prison. Horton fled, kidnapped a young couple, stabbing the man and repeatedly raping his girlfriend. Weekend prison passes. Dukakis on crime.
Massive deregulation in the financial sector under the Reagan administration, massive financial fraud, economic collapse that endured for several years, leading to massive loss of jobs and wealth in housing. I don't know if you recognize that pattern. But that was 1988. And George Bush was in trouble till he came up with this ad. So he started running this ad about this, about Willie Horton kidnapping, stabbing, raping, tying him to the Democratic candidate. How should the Democrats respond, okay? How should we respond to dog whistle politics? Well, remember I said back in 1970, the Democrats realized that race could be used as a weapon against them. So what did they say in 1970? They said, shh, stay silent. Don't talk about race. This is just a backlash. It's something natural. This generation, they'll get over it or die. Wait them out. This is all going to go away. Don't talk about race. We lose too much ground when we talk about race. So when this ad came out, Democrats followed that same playbook and they stayed silent, and 12% of the electorate switched their support from the Democrat to Bush. And this ad, more than anything else in the campaign, explains Bush's victory. Okay, so staying silent, it doesn't work. So they tried another approach, Jesse Jackson. 3 weeks before before the actual election, finally stood up and said, this is ugly race baiting. This is racial demagoguery. This is playing to the lowest instincts of the voters. And the press responded. They said, yes, it's mudslinging. It's race baiting. It's racial demagoguery. Yes, it is. So shut up, Jesse Jackson, you race baiter. Because, see, dog whistle politics is part of a larger rhetoric on race, and here's how it goes. Conservatives talk about race all the time in coded terms. Then, if you say, hey, that's race, they turn around and say, I didn't say the word black, I didn't say Mexican, I didn't use a racial epithet, so I can't be racist, and by the way, you've really hurt my feelings. Right? George Bush was really offended when Jesse Jackson said this is racist, really hurt him. And then they turn around and do one more thing. They strike back. And they said, but I'll tell you who did say the word race. I'll tell you who did say the word black. It's you, critic. You, Jesse Jackson. You said the word race first. And because you said the word race first, you're the real racist. And that happens to all of us. Whenever we talk about race, there's almost certainly, and racial equity, there's almost certainly going to be somebody who responds to us by saying, racists. And you're racist when you talk about race. That's just part of the conservative rhetoric about race. And so Jesse Jackson got slammed for being the real racist. And the Democrats, they were stymied. Stay silent, you lose. Speak out, you lose. What should you do? Bill Clinton figured it out. Or at least he came up with one solution.
They're a new generation of Democrats, Bill Clinton and Al Gore, and they don't think the way the old Democratic Party did. They've called for an end to welfare as we know it, so welfare can be a second chance, not a way of life. They've sent a strong signal to criminals by supporting the death penalty, and they've rejected the old tax and spend politics. Clinton's balanced 12 budgets, and they've proposed a new plan investing in people, detailing $140 billion in spending cuts they'd make right now. Clinton Gore, for people, for a change.
End welfare as a way of life. Well, whose way of life is it exactly? Crack down on crime. Well, who are the criminals? Cut government. Why? Because government's the problem? How did Clinton beat the Republicans? By joining them. He joined them. He picked up their themes. Right? This is how the Democrats finally figured out how to respond to dog whistle politics. By engaging it themselves. And so since the 90s, we've been in a political situation in which both parties have been competing for white votes by trying to demonstrate that they will do the most to crack down on unruly minorities and to slash government. And so when you see that inequality rising, it's not just Republicans who are at fault. The Democrats have largely joined them. That's the situation in which we find ourselves. Bill Clinton, back again. I'm skipping ahead. This is 2012, actually. This is a Mitt Romney ad. This is a Mitt Romney ad, and he's invoking Bill Clinton. Watch this.
In 1996, President Clinton and a bipartisan Congress helped end welfare as we know it by requiring work for welfare. But on July 12th, President Obama quietly announced a plan to gut welfare reform by dropping work requirements. Under Obama's plan, you wouldn't have to work and wouldn't have to train for a job. They just send you your welfare check. And welfare to work goes back to being plain old welfare. Mitt Romney will restore the work requirement because it works.
I'm Mitt Romney, and I approve this message.
Okay, so first, Mitt Romney spent half his advertising budget on this ad. This is not just some random Mitt Romney, you know, pulled it off of Fox TV ad. Half of his advertising budget went into this. Second, the ad is factually false. Obama did no such thing in terms of welfare. In fact, as you probably know, Obama's been cracking down on welfare and deporting people and doing all that bad stuff too. He did no such thing. In fact, PolitiFact gave this ad a pants on fire rating. Right? And this produced my second favorite moment of the campaign, because a Romney campaign spokesperson then responded to PolitiFact by saying, "We will not let our campaign be dictated by the facts." No, you wouldn't want that, because it's the frame. And the frame is, hey, you know, there are some good Democrats. Democrats who try and end welfare as a way of life, Bill Clinton. But there are some bad Democrats like Barack Obama who are going to take us right back to the Democrat government giveaway to minority days. Right? Whether it's true or not, that was the frame. And now look how deep the frame is. Because when Nixon used it, when Reagan used it, what they were saying is government and the Democratic Party is basically for minorities. But when Romney says it, he's saying it's for minorities and it's by minorities. Right? And it's got all that much more punch to it. Okay, but now, on to my favorite moment of the campaign, the Romney 47% snippet. And here's the question for you. Romney's going to talk about half the country. Is this dog whistle politics?
There are 47% of the people who vote for the president no matter what. All right, there are 47% who are with him, who are dependent upon government, who believe that they are victims, who believe that government has a responsibility to care for them, who believe that they're entitled to health care, to food, to housing, to you name it. But that's an entitlement, and the government should give it to them. And they will vote for this president no matter what. And so my job is not to worry about those people. I'll never convince them. They should take personal responsibility and care for their lives. What I have to do is convince the 5 to 10% in the center.
They have an entitlement mentality. They refuse to take responsibility for themselves. Don't have to care about them. Is this dog whistle politics? Well, no, because he's talking about half the country. He's not just talking about minorities, but obviously, yes. This is dog whistle politics, but what we're seeing is that the sort of terms, the racial terms that were used to demonize minorities are now being transferred not just to the poor, but to the middle class itself, right? Romney's saying half the country, and he's getting that 47% from the people who don't pay income tax, and let me just bracket this really quickly. People, you know, half the country doesn't pay income tax, but they pay property tax, they pay sales tax, they pay Social Security tax. In short, many of them pay over 14% of their total income in tax, even if they're not paying income tax, which is more than Mitt Romney pays, I just want to say, right? But never mind that. He's taking the racial language and applying it to half the country, and he's saying, and I want to be clear about this, he's saying, I want to be president of this great country, and I don't care about half of you all. And now in terms of policies, he's going on to say, here's what I propose to do 2012 in the wake of the second biggest economic calamity since the Great Depression. I promise you I will slash taxes for the very rich. I will cut government. I will deregulate and hand over to corporations control of regulations. That's what he was promising to do, the very things that had put us deep in the hole in the first place, while saying to the country, I don't care about half of you. So most of you know he lost. How about among whites? How did Mitt Romney do among whites? If only whites had voted, Mitt Romney would be our president. He won not just in the South, but across the entire country. He won not just among men, but among women. He won in every age cohort of whites. Mitt Romney won 3 out of 5 white votes. Three out of five whites voted for a presidential candidate whose anarchic vision was basically, if you're in the bottom half of the country, you're on your own. I really just care about corporations. Three out of five whites. And this is where we are now. This is where we are now. Right? It's slightly worse. 59% of whites voted for Mitt Romney in 2014 midterm elections. 62% of whites voted for white candidates, white Republican candidates. Right. So we are deep in the throes of dog whistle politics. And I want to emphasize this. This is not a story of racial backlash that develops in 64, peaks in 72, and has been declining since then. When you look at this result, the only presidential candidates who have done better than Mitt Romney in terms of the proportion of the white vote are Richard Nixon in his re-election and Ronald Reagan in his re-election. Right? We are at high, and I worry, increasing levels of racial polarization in voting patterns. Okay, what are we going to do? Well, let's start with the caveat. Demography will not save us. Demography will not save us. So here's what's happening with a lot of Democrats. A lot of Democrats are responding to this by saying, stay silent. Stay silent. This is all going to go away. Yeah, you know, it's been 50 years, but numbers are changing. The Census Bureau tells us by 2042, whites are going to be a minority. It's all going to end. Stay silent. This is terrible advice. It's terrible advice. Why? For a couple of reasons. One, telling anxious white voters that by 2042 they'll be a minority does not garner their support. Right? I mean, the social science is clear. The more whites come to understand that their proportion of the country is declining, the more they become anxious, the more they become politically conservative and racially resentful. Right? So that's just not a good message. Two, this is about whiteness and not about whites. And what I mean by that is the boundaries of who counts as white is sure to expand. This isn't about European descent. This isn't about blue eyes. This is about thinking that you're better than others and that others are inferior and dangerous on racial lines. And that plays out certainly in the Latino community. Already about half of Latinos identify themselves as white. And so Census Bureau tells us whites are going to be a minority in this country in 2042. They're 65% of the population now. They'll be a minority in 2042, unless you include Latinos who consider themselves white. And if you do, then in 2042, whites will be 72% of this country. We might not be in a period in which the white population is contracting. We might be in a period in which the white population is expanding, because it's about whiteness. And we've seen a history of whiteness expanding from the Anglo-Saxon to include the German, to include the Irish, to include the Italian and the Jew. I think we may well see an expansion that includes significant segments of the Latino population, significant segments of the Asian population, and frankly, functionally, some elite African Americans as well. They are going to operate as essentially honorary whites. And you think the Republican Party is going to say, no, we'd rather reject you than hold on to power? No way. They're already figuring out how to appeal to these sectors of communities that in 64 might have been non-white, but will be accepted as white now if willing to engage in this politics of racial resentment. Demography is not going to save us. What will? We need an inclusion revolution. We need a social movement. And here's what I mean. Democrats have been fighting this sort of politics for a long time, thinking, we need to just talk about policies, and we need to just talk about material interests. We need to show people how we're better for them in terms of upward mobility, in terms of wages, in terms of environmental protection, without fully grappling with the idea that what we're dealing with is identity and fear. That the Republicans have been saying to people, you're being disrespected. Your position in society is being eroded. You're under threat. You're not important. These people are taking away from you. And the only way to respond to that sort of existential crisis is in existential terms, is in terms that says to people, no, take pride in who you are. Take pride in the work you've done. Take pride in what you've contributed to your family. but do so on the basis of inclusion, on the basis of building this country, on the basis of taking power back from the very rich to share with all of us. This has to be a social movement. And that means when we talk about race, when we try and build this new identity, we can't do so in the last 3 weeks of the campaign. Cannot do so in the last 3 weeks of the campaign. And it's not something that's actually going to happen by 2016, even if we start now. Right? This is going to be a 5 to 10 to 15 year project. We have to understand ourselves to be in a project. What is the project? To give people an affirmative sense of who we are as Americans that is broadly inclusive, so that people will respond to politicians who are saying to them, "Fear the least powerful among you," by saying, "Why should I fear them? I share their hopes. I suffer the way they do. I share their dreams. I worry about my children the way they do. Why should I fear them? I need to fear the Koch brothers." Right? But that needs to be a social movement, an identity-based social movement, long term. Core to that social movement, good government. We've really, as liberals, moved away from progressives talking about government, but my gosh, you folks know more than anybody else, in a complex, industrialized society like ours, government is key. Government is absolutely key. It pools all of our resources, it regulates our lives, it creates routes of upward mobility, or instead, it shifts power inward and upward. And that's what conservatives have understood, that through government they can shift power inward and upward, and we have got to create a sense that the role of government is to push power downwards and outwards. We need government on our side. If we don't have government on our side, if government remains in the pockets of the billionaires, we will never have a fair and equitable society. Never. Right? And we don't stress that enough. So we need to stress, as part of our social movement, that we're all in this together, and government must be on our side. That's one of our goals, to take government back, right, for all of us. Okay, what does this mean for you? So I say beyond policy. How do we do the social movement thing? How do we create a new sense of government? You can't do it whole cloth. You got to do it starting from where you are. And where are you? Well, you guys are doing amazing work to try and build racial equity. I look through the program, Ban the Box, regional initiatives about utilities, planning, mass incarceration, just all of these different initiatives. Great. But you understand that in some ways, given this 50-year history, those things are radically incommensurate with the scale of the problem. And also, you're being demonized for trying to do them, right? I am not saying abandon those efforts. I'm saying double down on them. I love those efforts. That's the way forward. But reimagine them as part of a larger goal of building a broad social movement that emphasizes inclusion and the role of good government. That is, work on two different levels. Yes, keep thinking about policy. Keep thinking about what's going to happen in a year or two. Keep thinking about measurables and deliverables. But also, think to yourself, the long-term goal, the more important goal, is this social movement, this new sense of who we are and this new sense of the role government has to play in our society. Design your policies, design your programs in a way that contributes to building a broad social movement and to a reimagining of government. That's what I'm suggesting. Have this larger context and this larger goal in mind. So that when you think strategically, okay, we're going to do racial equity, we're going to do sort of investment in different neglected parts of our community, how are you going to do so in a way that connects up with creating a narrative of inclusion, that creates a narrative of good government that helps everybody? That's the sort of conversation that I want you to have. Last point, interest convergence. I am saying to you, attend to the politics of whiteness. Think about how whites are reacting to what we're doing, because conservatives have been using this as a weapon not just against communities of color, but against all Americans, against the 99% for 50 years. I am not saying help whites first. I am saying two things. You want to do something for communities of color? Then you got to figure out how to win white support. And you want to do anything in long term in terms of pushing power downward and outward in our society, then you have to think about what's happening with whites politically. We just don't have a choice. And I'm calling this interest convergence because this is a term used by a former professor of mine. I think a lot of you know his work, Derrick Bell. Right? And Derrick Bell said clearly, some whites respond to the moral argument that they should do right, that they should do justice. Most whites respond when it's in their interest to do so. And let's be clear, when it's in their interest to do so, they then adopt the moral language. But what's driving people is the sense that it's in their interest. Interest convergence means if we want racial justice, if we want a fair and inclusive society that works for all, we need to talk to whites. Not to displace attention on minorities, but because whites continue to hold so much power in our society. And if we don't attend to how whites are reacting to what we're doing, we'll continue to lose. And they will continue to lose. We will all continue to lose. What I'm saying is we are at a moment when we can shift the direction of racial equity. We can shift the direction of democracy. We can shift the direction of social policy by grabbing onto this idea, this simple idea. We are all in this together, across lines of race, across lines of gender and sexual orientation and class and religion and whether we own guns or not. We are all in this together. We need that inclusion revolution. And the goal of that inclusion revolution should be to take back government and to create the sort of government that helps create a vibrant, fair, and inclusive society for all. That's what we're trying to do. Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you all.